Good afternoon. My name is Robert Pine. I'm Program Director for the Mothi Center. I'd like to welcome you to this program, which is the last in a series of webinars to discuss refugee resettlement in America, and here in Brown County, Wisconsin, in particular. This program is co-sponsored by Catholic Charities of the Diocese of Green Bay, Wisconsin Literacy, and the Mothi Center. The Mothi Center is an independent nonprofit on the campus of the University of Wisconsin, Green Bay, dedicated to the promotion of peace, justice, and mutual respect, supporting individual and community flourishing while welcoming all cultures and faiths. The center's educational programs create space for curiosity, reflection, and respectful conversation, addressing vital concerns as we seek to move forward together. Wisconsin Literacy is a nonprofit statewide coalition of literacy agencies. They strengthen literacy statewide through expert training, personalized consultations, health literacy, workforce connections, and advocacy. Catholic Charities of the Diocese of Green Bay is an affiliate agency of the United States Catholic Conference of Bishops, one of the few national organizations authorized by the U.S. State Department to resettle refugees. Catholic Charities is the only agency managing initial resettlement and placement for newly arrived refugees during their first 3 months in Brown County, and they collaborate with many other offices and nonprofits to provide extended support beyond that crucial three-month period. Before introducing our guests for this afternoon, I'd like to note that we will have time at the end to address some of your questions, which can be submitted at any time using the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. Today, we're going to be joined first by Doug Pagitt, founder of Vote Common Good, and then by asylum attorney Sara Ghadiri. We're going to start with Doug, who I first met about 20 years ago when he was pastor of Solomon's Porch in Minneapolis. Doug is an author, activist, and now executive director of Vote Common Good. He's worn a lot of hats, sometimes literally, but in all of his different roles, I know Doug is a leader who is genuine, generous, and visionary. He's always looking for ways to make a difference in the world, and he's actually doing it. Doug, my friend, welcome.
Wow. Hey, Bob, really good to see you. Thanks for inviting me to be part of this, and Sara, with you as well. Really glad to. You know, this issue matters a lot, and I know so many of us care about it, and not enough of us, and I put myself in this camp a few years ago, just don't even know all of what's going on. So I think this is super valuable. Thanks for putting it together.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. I wanted to ask you first, and then I'm going to just hand it over to you for a little bit. How did a Minnesota guy become so engaged with issues on the southern border?
Yeah, that's a great question. I some days I ask myself that. You know, I do live in a border state, as you in Wisconsin do, but we don't talk about the U.S.-Canadian border in the same way we do the U.S.-Mexico border. And my whole life, I had heard about the border, of course, as so many people do. There's a lot of American legend about the border, you know, as a person of a certain age, there's rock music that runs through my head about, you know, make a run for the border, or I shot a man on the Mexican border, just kind of the lore about the border. I'd spent a lot of time in Texas. I'd been to Brownsville, but really to see the beaches. I'd spent a lot of time in New Mexico and much time in Southern California and Arizona, but had never gone to the United States-Mexico border. There was never a reason to. Donald Trump was then elected, and I was a pastor of an evangelical church. And when I started hearing Donald Trump talking about the border and building a wall and continuing the wall building, it reminded me that the U.S. government had been making decisions about building a wall on our southern border. And then Donald Trump villainizing all the people who were coming into the United States just felt wrong to me and felt off. And then started talking about using family separation policy to prevent people from seeking refugee in the refugee status in the United States. And that really, you know, struck at my conscience. And so I started hunting for ways to go to the border. And to be truthful, I didn't know where to go. I didn't know who, like, if I wanted to go to the border, which I did, like, well, there's not like a hotline for call people at the border and go. So I didn't know. So I hooked up with a couple of groups that had some actions and protests there. We went to El Paso first. And so a group of faith leaders met in El Paso, and we saw that portion of the border, which is where the border wall actually was initially started, in El Paso, Texas, under the direction of a particular sheriff there, and learned a lot about what was happening at the border. And then we decided that as an organization, Vote Common Good, which you can see all the stuff that we do at votecommongood.com, we believed that going to the border was going to be a crucial part of the work we do. The work we do is to help faith voters know that they have voting options beyond their what their political identity was given to them by their religious connections. A lot of evangelicals and Catholic voters have been told that the only thing they can do to be faithful to their religious commitments is to vote for Republicans. And we wanted people to know they have a lot more choice than that. So we wanted to do a number of things, including helping people realize what's actually happening at the border. But in order to do that, we needed to go to the border. And we also knew the power of documentaries. So in 2021, we put together a plan to ride bicycles from San Diego, California to St. Augustine, Florida. Every mile along the U.S.-Mexico border, as close to the border wall as we could get, meeting people in the towns, crossing the border, meeting with Border Patrol, meeting with activists on both sides, meeting with people doing care and resettlement work along the border, going into Mexico and meeting with people in the Remain in Mexico camps that are there, people that are just stuck living on the street. And so for 67 days, we bicycled from California to St. Augustine, Florida, and then also along the coast, so along the U.S.-Mexico border and along the coast, because we wanted to understand America. We wanted to understand our southern border. And it was revelatory, meeting the people that we saw there. When you're on a bicycle, you have to go slow. And you also feel the air. You feel the road. You meet the people. We watched people being detained, crossing in the desert. We met people whose feet were blistered. We met people who were in danger. And most importantly, we met people along the U.S.-Mexico border who live there, on the Mexico side and on the U.S. side. And what we learned is that for people who live along the border, they don't like the way Republicans talk about the border. They don't like the way most Americans talk about the border. They don't like the way Democrats talk about the border. They begged us over and over when we would ask them, what message do you want us to convey to people elsewhere in the country? They would say, please ask people to stop slandering us. Now, this was people on all sides of the political aisle. I'm going to show you a couple of videos of people that we met. Hardcore Trump supporters saying this wall makes no sense. And please tell people that what's happening at the border is peaceful and good communities and kindness. And the people coming in this country want to make America better. And all these other rumors that people are spreading about the border are not true. I even wondered if we would be unsafe being at the border. We brought a lot of people down to ride bicycles with us or come down for a day or two. And we still do that work if someone wants to contact us and have access to meeting people along the border. So we got close and we're making a documentary about it. I'm going to show you a couple of clips on it. Here's one for this documentary that we're putting together. And the documentary is nearly complete. And we'd really invite people to go to the We the People Ride website if they want to see some of this. So, all right. I'm hoping this is sharing. Are you seeing that?
Yep, somebody, you can see it.
Okay. All right. Thank you. All right, here we go. So this is us starting with our bicycles in Mexico, and then this is a portion from the documentary.
Where we're going to ride our bikes from San Diego across the country to St. Augustine, Florida. Do that along and as near to the U.S.-Mexico border as we can to bear witness to the experience of people. It's going to take us 67 days to do this.
There we go. Our primary effort is to take the stories that we learn along the border and to tell them over time with people around the United States.
They killed her husband. And they have nowhere to go.
Especially in places that we think the political opinion about the border could really have impact on who we are as a country and who represents us.
Republicans have made a deliberate effort to talk to religious voters. And we really believe many evangelical voters really do want to find a new option.
This is the way we choose in this country to manage this part of the border, is to make this desert so deadly that if anyone crosses here, they're going to suffer in the desert.
Todos son muertos.
Todos.
We're 400 feet to a water tank and 800 feet to the road. Just didn't quite make it.
The systems that are created, they didn't just exist. Someone made them. And if we made them, we can change them.
So our notion of this work is that we believe that the policies in the United States are causing the problem on the U.S.-Mexico border. And we know that these policies have to change. And if it was as simple, honestly, as just voting for one political party versus the other, that would be wonderful. But it's not the case, as it turns out. People across the country need to understand our border situation, the rules of what it takes to come into the country. And I know Sarah's here and she's going to be able to share some of that, how complex it is, how limiting it is, how painful it is for so many people, that these are the lessons that we wanted to learn as we travel along the Mexico-U.S. border, to ask ourselves, why is it like this? We made these policies in the United States. We've created the very situation that has created the problem, and we can be the solution. Now, we have a very strong political opinion. We think that one political party is way better than the other. And if you ever want to ask me about that, I'd be glad to tell you. But we also know that we have to work with people in every sector, on every side of the issues, to be sure that we solve this problem. It has been a problem in this country. Immigration and who can be in this country has been a problem from the beginning of this nation. The fundamental question, who's the we of we the people, is the fundamental question that we think we have to answer in this country. And it's not entirely clear. Now, there are a lot of people saying that they want to seal off the border, they want to close the border, they want to deport people. We think that is not the way to go, and we don't want it to go that way. Do I have another minute to show one video?
Yes, definitely.
Okay. I want to introduce you to a person that we met at this little honky-tonk bar. It's called the Junkyard Bar. It's in McAllen, Texas, just outside of McAllen, Texas. The bar was there right on the border, right near the border. And then during the Trump years, they decided to build a portion of the wall. The Trump administration built about 52 miles of new wall total along the U.S.-Mexico border, and some of it was right here. They didn't complete all of it, and they put it right in the backyard of this bar. Now, the actual border to the country is about 300 yards away from the wall, but it's a river because that's how the border is managed in Texas. It's all along the Rio Grande River. But they built this wall. So we pulled into this junkyard bar. It's 2:00 in the afternoon, but a lot of retirees have moved to this part of Texas, and they're in this bar. And we're on our bicycles, and we roll up, and it's a honky-tonk. And I love myself a honky-tonk. So we roll into this bar and start chatting with people. We meet a guy from Minnesota. Northern Minnesota, and I want you to meet him. So this is some of the people we met along the way. So I got to move my cursor back around. Bicycles, yeah, that's our bikes up there.
Oh, wow.
I think this is the border, guys. Right? Yeah. We illegally crossed it.
We started riding in San Diego.
Oh, wow. Okay.
We're going into Reynosa, Mexico tomorrow. And
you're going into Reynosa,
yeah,
huh?
We work with people that do humanitarian work with migrants and asylum seekers.
So you've got people with you.
Yeah.
Because Reynosa's not a really good place. Now you go in Progreso, you don't need anybody with you. But if you're going to go to Reynosa, you need people with you.
Yeah, we were.
I'm originally from Minnesota.
How are you?
I just want to know those people over there are Minnesotans.
Oh, these two sitting at the table?
Yeah, they just bought the valley. They're from Northern Minnesota.
I was just thinking about it when you came over. I'm looking around going, this is just like any other town in the States that you go to. You want to go have a beer, you go have a beer, there's great music. This just happens to be right on the border. I mean, you can't get any closer to the border than there. And it's no different. I mean, yeah, there are issues.
Yeah.
But I think for the most part, people just carry on, you know.
Yeah. So many people in Minnesota would be afraid to come to the border.
Absolutely.
Maybe you've heard it too. Have you
Absolutely.
Heard people
yes.
tell you that they, yes. you should be afraid to come
Are
here?
You really going down the mission? Well, yeah. We've enjoyed it so far. Matter of fact, in 10 days, we bought a house here. So we're going to be here 7 months and in northern Minnesota, 5 months.
And all this stuff about worry about the border, all the stuff you hear, that didn't cause you to wait?
No.
Like, you decided to do it now?
No, yeah, we just, time was right for us to sell. Yeah.
I'm heartbroken every time. I mean, the river has been the life force of the Rio Grande,
mm-hmm.
and it's been shared by both sides, and you negotiate the border. Then a wall comes up, and it just says something
yeah,
else.
You know?
What do you think?
There's got to be a better way. I don't know what it is, I guess, or... I may be gone before that's found.
Isn't that sad?
Yeah. So that's the kind of experience that we had over and over. Traveling along the U.S.-Mexico border, people that were moving there, that person was going to move to Mission, Texas, right on the border. After visiting there for 10 days, they loved it so much. They'd been vacationing there, and they decided they were going to make a permanent place for 7 months of the year. We met people who were mayors of towns on the U.S.-Mexico border, begging people to come for tourism because it's a good place and it's safe. The border is safe for Americans. What it's not safe for are the migrants. Our U.S. policy has created conditions that have made coming into the United States mandatory to be engaged with criminal syndicates in Mexico because of U.S. policy. People on every side, Border Patrol agents, people who live there, people in Mexico, have all told us that U.S. policy of the border is most appreciated by the human trafficking and drug cartels in Mexico. It has made them wealthy beyond their imagination, so much more wealthy than trafficking drugs is U.S. border policy, because what they charge people to cross the border or to even get close to the border. So our U.S. policy is the problem. Everyone seems to know it and understand it. In that little bar, I didn't talk to everyone in the bar. We talked to maybe 60% of them. Everyone that offered up their political opinion, Trump supporters, all of them, different than me. And they all thought the wall made no sense, and they all wanted people to stop slandering the border over and over and over. So why is it the way that it is? Why aren't we telling the more broad story? We're going to do what we can with our documentary. We're going to do what we can in seminars like this and partnering with people. So I just want to thank all of you for any of your care and concern. Glad to answer some other questions about the work that we do. I just want to be an advocate for people to know that our border is America. By the way, the borderlands, it's part of the United States of America. And we should treat it like it is. And we should treat our border policies like they make sense for the United States of America. And they can be better, and we should free up our Border Patrol agents and Homeland Security to be dealing with the threats that might oppose the United States, and not treating regular people seeking asylum or access to the United States as if they're criminals for simply seeking to access the United States through our southern border. All right, so glad to take some questions in a bit, and I very much look forward to hearing from Sara.
Great, thank you, Doug. So Sara Ghadiri, I'm gonna ask you to go ahead and join us now as well. Sara is an asylum attorney based here in the Green Bay area. She's the pro bono counsel for Chapman, a law firm with offices in several major cities of the US, including Chicago. We're really fortunate to have Sara here in our community. She's on the board of COMSA, which is a resource center serving immigrants and refugees in Brown County. She's been extremely helpful, both in direct service to that community and in helping the rest of us understand the complex services, complex challenges they face. So, Sara, welcome. And I want to just
thank you so much for
a quick response to what Doug just shared. And Doug, stay with us so we can have some conversation.
Doug is spot on. The cruelty is the point. And that's what I keep going back to every time, you know, I talk about these things. A couple of quick disclaimers, though. These are my personal opinions. I'm not giving anybody legal advice. This is just, you know, overview information to try to help you all be better citizens and make good choices about what policies you want to advocate for and believe in. So like Dr. Pine said, I am an attorney. I am primarily focused on human rights work. And that means that I do a lot of humanitarian immigration work. And so I am intimately connected with the communities and the folks that are trying to come here to escape persecution, escape violence in their home countries, and have a chance at living somewhere safely. I want to talk a little bit about the difficulties of how this whole system works and why one of the reasons why it's so complicated. And explain to you exactly what someone would need to do in order to win an asylum claim. So I think that's part of, you know, the difficulty and complicatedness of this whole situation. So first, a couple of vocabulary things. Under U.S. law, an asylee is defined as someone who enters the United States and then claims for protection. A refugee is somebody who is outside the United States claiming for protection. So when we talk about refugees and asylees and recent arrivals and immigrants and stuff like that, these all have different meanings. And the definition of an asylee actually comes from the definition of a refugee that's from the UN Convention. And so when we talk about international law and how United States policies need to comply with international law and saying things like, we're gonna not let anybody apply for asylum and those types of protective claims is against international law. I mean, that's just what it is. And so in order to win an asylum claim, you have to get here first, right? You have to get on U.S. soil in some way. And the majority of people that I think Doug talked to are people who are crossing the southern border, but they're not all people from Mexico and Central America. There are people who come from Africa that fly to Brazil and walk or take buses all the way to the U.S. border. And so I think there's a disproportionate understanding of who these people are. There are Afghans who waited years for the United States to get them out of a dangerous situation that had no choice other than to do that and present at the southern border. So it's not just Mexicans. It's not just people from Central America. It's not just Venezuelans. It's not just anything. It's people from around the world that are trying to come in the best way that they can. And so these folks, when they're coming into the United States and they're crossing a border or whatever, at great personal cost, at great personal risk, many folks are coming here having actually suffered persecution. And that's what the legal test is. To say that you are an asylee, that you're entitled to protection, you have to pass this legal test, which means that you need to prove that you were persecuted, which has a legal definition, by the government or somebody the government is unable or unwilling to control on account of some characteristic about you that you shouldn't have to change or that you can't change. So that can be your religion, that can be your political opinion, that could be that you're LGBT, that could be that you resisted a gang or that you are suffering from gender-based violence in a country that doesn't care, right? All those types of things can qualify. But you have to meet that legal test. And in order to even be able to try, you have to be given what's called a credible fear interview. And that's usually what happens at the border. And these recent executive orders change how this works. It changes who can apply. It changes how you have to apply and the threshold that you have to meet. But even assuming you get a credible fear, you explain to the government why you're afraid and you have a legitimate credible fear, you're then put in a line, right? And you can either be in front of the asylum office or you can be in front of an immigration court. The majority of people that are coming through that get caught, get placed in what's called in proceedings. We don't call them deportation anymore, we call it removal. but it's not any less horrible. It's the same exact thing. And so depending on where people are ending up, they're put into lines in immigration courts throughout the United States. And for example, anybody who is in Indiana, Wisconsin, or Illinois ends up at the Chicago Immigration Court. So people who are ending up, you know, dispersed throughout the United States might actually have to go a very long way to get to an immigration court. And so there are districts, you know, throughout how everything works is that geographically, cases are sort of dispersed that way. There are allegedly going to be new immigration courts coming in Milwaukee and in Indianapolis, but who knows when that's going to happen. There's no money. At this point, you have 700 immigration judges that are covering the entire United States. That means about each judge has a docket of about 5,000 cases. 5,000 cases, not 500, 5,000. And until we figure out a way to appropriately fund all of this, it doesn't matter how many executive orders get passed, how much we deal with folks getting bused all over the place. Just in Chicago alone, from the border, 44,000 people have been bused up to Chicago. Over 100,000 have been bused to New York City, right? And so those areas that have immigration courts there have only just been backlogged further. And you may have heard about rocket dockets or recent arrival dockets. Those are happening in 5 cities throughout the United States. Chicago is one of them. And we are seeing an attempt to fast track people. What does that mean? They don't get access to counsel. They don't have enough time for a legal aid organization or private attorney to find them, to get enough money to do any of those things. And so when I started this by saying the cruelty is the point, it ties exactly to what Doug was saying, which is we created this system and we can change it, but there has to be some kind of will to do it. And right now, you know, you see a Senate bill come up proposing 100 more judges, more funding for CBP, more funding for other things. And the problem is, and it always has been, resources. A system will fail if it's not appropriately resourced. And so I think that's one of the reasons why we really need to think about comprehensive immigration reform and what it means for the nuts and bolts for the people who are standing in those deserts waiting for an opportunity to get protection from people in their country or their governments who can't protect them.
So, Sara, when you think about comprehensive immigration reform, we know that there's been a spike in global migration since the pandemic.
It's the highest number of people, displaced people since World War II right now.
And a huge increase in encounters at the US border. We know that arrivals are coming from more countries than ever before. You mentioned some coming from Africa. There are people coming from China to the southern border, an increasing number. Their journey is more perilous than ever, in part because of the numbers, but also because of the heat. And more than ever before, they come as families requesting asylum. Now, again, just to clarify, asylum seekers have a legal right to have their cases adjudicated, to have their requests given a fair hearing while they seek humanitarian protection. And some of the international bodies or international agreements that pertain to refugees or asylees, potential asylees, do not apply equally to migrants, that is to people seeking jobs. So economic
Absolutely.
Migrants
yeah.
versus asylum seekers versus refugees. And those lines probably look fairly clean legally, but in practice, not so clean.
Absolutely. We see that all the time. Most of the people that I talk to are unable to get jobs or unable to support their families. And sometimes those reasons are because of political things, right? Or because they're from an ethnic minority that is heavily discriminated, right? But there's always a lot of overlap between people who, you know, have a viable asylum claim versus, you know, people who are coming here for work. And I think one of the challenges that we have is that there are a lot of people who need protection, right? Who might not qualify for asylum. So for example, we have a bunch of people coming from Venezuela. It's one of the number one groups we've seen spike because of political reasons. And so we have now temporary protected status for Venezuelans, right? And what is TPS? TPS is temporary, right? But it is protection from deportation, but it does not lead to a green card. It does not lead to citizenship. It says, hey, we understand that things in your country maybe are not the greatest right now, so we'll let you stay here, but you got to go back once that's sorted out, right? And the problem with TPS is that it can be authorized for as long as the government wants, right? We could be looking at 10, 15 years during a civil war. If you look at Syria, for example, has been reauthorized over and over and over again. And these people come here, they build lives, and then they have nothing, right? And so it's a real shame that we keep using these temporary Band-Aid solutions rather than coming together and saying, hey, okay, if there are people who want to come here for work, let's try to figure out if we can create a better system for people who want to work here. For example, point-based system like in Canada, not saying it's the best, but for those of you who aren't familiar, Canada's immigration system works very differently, giving folks who want to come for jobs different points based on the skills that they have, the languages they speak, et cetera, and allows there to be more migration for people who want to come for jobs. Here, because one of the only ways to come is through a humanitarian protection, it makes those lines get very blurred, and people try to come up with whatever they think will make them sort of shoehorn into that category. If we did a better job creating better mechanisms for coming to the United States, because it's not going to stop. It hasn't stopped since the beginning. When people talked about the Muslim ban, everybody's like, oh my gosh, how could this happen? And if you look at history, if you're a student of history, you look at it and you say, well, this has happened so many times before.
Right.
None of this is new. And that's what Doug was saying from the beginning too.
Doug, how does that square with some of the people you talked to along the way?
Man, Sara, you are spot on with it. Let me give another picture of what actually happens. Like Sara said, the difference is between a migrant who's seeking like a work permit and a refugee, somebody who's in a refugee camp in another country but wants to come to the United States, and an asylum seeker, three different words that all feel like they're kind of synonyms to us, but as Sara said, in the legal status, they really matter. To seek asylum, you have to be physically on U.S. property. Now, this is so essential because this is why people are, quote, illegally crossing the border. Here's what happens. When you come up to the U.S.-Mexico border, there are border crossings. I've been to nearly all of them. And in nearly all of them, the same set of conditions apply. There's a border agent. And somewhere in the middle of the bridge, if it's over a river, or before the U.S. border on the Mexico side, the United States Border Patrol agents are placed. Before you get to the technical legal one-inch crossing the U.S.-Mexico border, and they screen people. Now, by international law, this is illegal. This is what we do on the border. So if you don't have an appointment to meet with an asylum judge, they turn you around and say, you have to wait until you get an appointment. And you might think, well, how does someone get an appointment with an asylum judge? They want you to have a cell phone that has internet access on it. And then you log into a website and you make an appointment. Now, I've sat just a month and a half ago with a bunch of people in a camp in Mexico. Most of them had appointments 6 or 8 months in the future. Where is a family who is fleeing danger in Venezuela, in Haiti, in Colombia, in Africa, in Mexico? Where are they supposed to be for 8 months? They have left everything. They know no one. They're on the run. They've had to pay drug and human trafficking cartels to let them make their way through Mexico or through Guatemala. Now they're living on the street, or they're in a refugee-supported space, asylum-seeking space, the kind of camps that people set up out of the goodness of their heart, with no funding from anyone. And they're supposed to just wait there for 8 months if they can get logged in to even get an appointment. These are terrorized people, often with children, who've left everything in a fleeing moment. Okay, so there's thousands of them that during the pandemic this thing called Title 42 said, we're not accepting any of these people in the country for the most part. So thousands of people over 2.5 years were backed up. That's why there's a huge surge. So if you're a father or a mother and you've got little children and you can't seem to get an appointment, and if you do get an appointment, you're 8 months down the road. You have nowhere to stay. You have no money. You're in Mexico, and drug and human trafficking cartels want to take your children. And there's a border crossing through a wall or over a wall or across a river. And if you cross that river, if you cross that wall and a border patrol agent picks you up, you can ask for asylum if you get across that border line. You can't do it at the border checkpoint because they're screening you out. But you can do it 15 feet, 500 feet, 3 miles up the river. You can cross. When they cross there, they say, I'm seeking asylum, and they're taken into the asylum process. And then we call that an illegal crossing. So we've essentially closed the border to 90% of asylum seekers, have a way for them to go around the door that is essentially locked, and then we call it illegal. Okay, that's what's happening. So if you wonder why there are so many illegal crossings, that's all technically called an illegal crossing. It drives you crazy that they're screening people out and then not letting them in. So if the door was wider, if there was more access for people, I'm sorry, tell me if I've gotten any of this stuff wrong.
No, you are spot on, Doug.
This is what's happening. So it is such madness creating, right? And there are thousands of people who, what we should have, Sara said, is plenty of ways for people to seek asylum. Now, asylum isn't even just one thing. So you know more of this than I do. A temporary protective status is one thing.
Yeah, for sure. There's lots of different.
It's so complicated. It's so expensive.
Yeah. You know, and I think that's the other thing that I want to touch on, Doug, is the cost, right? There's the cost of getting your body over the border, right? And that's emotional cost. That's physical cost. That's, you know, like obviously cost actual money, right? And then you're here. And you have no job, you have no authorization to work until you file your asylum application. And then you have to wait 180 days before you can get a work permit, right? And so people are basically here and they want to work. They want to do stuff, right? They want us to support their families, but we're making it extra difficult for them to do that by making there be so many extra hurdles, right? And then once you find an attorney or somebody who can file your asylum application, assuming you're not getting a notario or somebody who's not actually an attorney who is filing a bogus claim for you that's going to get you deported, right? There are not enough lawyers. There's not enough money that's given to legal services organizations. So you might have heard of the Legal Services Corporation. Most people haven't, but it's an organization that's set up by Congress to fund civil legal aid. Mm. None of that money can go towards immigration.
Yeah.
None of it. You have all of these so many limited resources and so many people who need it. It's terrible.
Okay. I want to tell you the story about Tiffany Burrows, who runs the Valverde Humanitarian Coalition in Del Rio, Texas. Valverde is the name of the county. In Del Rio, Texas, small little town. If you ever want to travel somewhere, you should go to Del Rio. It's fantastic. Great place. Small little town, like all the border towns are. There's a surge of crossings happening in Del Rio. Maybe you remember a few years ago when there were many, many Haitian peoples crossing, and that's when you saw the guy with the whip on the horse, the Border Patrol agent, that whole thing, all the people. Well, look, first of all the Haitians don't get together after leaving Haiti 8 or 10 years ago and then living in South America and making their way to the border, and all of them end up in Del Rio by accident. It's the human trafficking and drug cartels that put certain people from certain countries into certain cities and then surge them across the border to create crisis so they can do other things in other parts of the border. So if you've ever wondered why are there pop-up surges here and there, it's because it's all part of a plan of people on the other side of the border that are human trafficking these folks. But anyway, all these people are coming into the country in Del Rio. So a pastor and Tiffany Burrows are asked by the city of Del Rio and by Border Patrol if they could create a nonprofit agency to help solve the problem. The federal government spending billions of dollars on border security then asks a nonprofit group with no money to solve the problem, because here's what was happening. Border Patrol, these people would cross, they would do a survey, an interview with them, say you legally have right to be in the United States, and then they would drop them at the Circle K gas station and just leave them there. No phones, no phone numbers, no money. So all of a sudden there's thousands of people in Del Rio. So they ask Tiffany to solve the problem. So Tiffany's fantastic. She does, all on her own, unpaid, spends day and night working with these asylum seekers. Border Patrol pulls up with buses when we were there with a manifest of the people. They get out of the Border Patrol bus and are turned over to Tiffany, who then is responsible to help them get to San Antonio or wherever else they're going to go in the country with no money. And not only this, she then had to rent a building that you're going to see in the video from the city that asked her to solve this problem. She rents it from the city of Del Rio, but the city tells her after she rents it that it's not up to occupancy code. So she has to raise money to fix the building that the city leased to her so she could do the work of the city. And this stuff, I am not exaggerating, goes on everywhere. The federal government of the United States is riding on the back of small nonprofits to solve these problems. So if you don't mind, it's not a long video, but I just think it's better not to hear me talk about it, but for you to see this. So this is Tiffany Burrows, who you're about to see right here. And it's a short interview with her. And then you'll have a chance to see what she's up to.
And while Doug is pulling that up, I want to share the very, very similar story.
Is that not working? Sorry about that.
No, we can't see it.
Okay.
There's an organization called ICDI in Chicago. It's the Interfaith Coalition for Detained Immigrants. And when people get picked up by ICE and are put in immigration detention, when they're released, they are released with nothing. Yeah. Literally what they had on their back. There's no money for them to get a bus ticket. There's no place for them to go. Literally, they just send them to the bus station in Chicago and they're like, here you go. It's the same exact
it's
thing.
Incredible. All over the
it's
country.
It's also part of the privatization of government services, yes. Where again and again, nonprofits, religious groups are asked to step in and fill the void. And
all right. I think I got this fixed.
Okay,
all
now, right. Now we can see it, Doug.
Thank
go
you.
Ahead.
Sorry about that. Like I've never run a Zoom meeting. There you go.
The third lesson is that it's nonprofit groups that are meeting the needs of people along the border. Our federal policies come up far short of where they should be. And it's nonprofit, often faith-based groups that have to step in and fill the gap and care for people.
Oh, I hope that you can just stay and watch the process.
We will.
Because
this is
what
it.
It's all about.
Okay. Coming.
Good morning.
Am I turning this thing?
Yes, you are. Oh, okay. So in spring of 19, our county experienced a surge. And at that time, Border Patrol was at capacity and didn't know really where to leave those people. And so it was creating a problem within the community. Border Patrol then reached out to all the pastors in our area. Out of that, one pastor in particular said, I think we can do this better. And his name was Pastor Sean Young, and he is with City Church.
What I saw underneath the bridge and the amount of people underneath the bridge, I mean, I never imagined seeing anything like that in Del Rio, you know, working with the immigrants for the last couple of years. That was an eye-opener. In this area, we've been seeing, if memory serves me right, 25 to 30,000 a month crossing the Del Rio sector. We haven't had a place to overnight. So they'll usually just wait at the airport, or they'll wait at the bus station overnight. You know, if it's a vulnerable mom with a baby, and you know, we'll obviously try to get her kind of placed if possible. Again, we're just so small and we just don't have the manpower ourselves. And we would definitely need buy-in from other entities and government entities to make that work.
And again, I just want to emphasize, this is you and Tiffany and a group of volunteers doing all of this work on behalf of migrants and in coordination with other federal agencies. to stand in the gap and make all that work.
It goes back to the fact that we are faith-based, and mm-hmm. helping others is a big part of what we do. And so when you're coming from that vantage point, it's really not that political. It's just what needs to be done.
We're very glad for the work of the Valverde Humanitarian Coalition. It's crucial work, but it's work that should be carried on in partnership with the federal government and paid for by the federal government. It doesn't make sense that small nonprofit groups like this have to carry all of this burden to care for people. It just rubs us the wrong way, and we think that there's a better way for us to move forward in our public policy and in how we spend our money along the U.S.-Mexico border.
All right, so that all comes out of some of this, these videos we've created in advocacy. Those backpacks they were handing out, those are filled by having an Amazon wish list. People around the country fill a backpack. They have no money to help these people once they're in the country. The policy of the U.S. government is, we will keep you out, we will spend money to vet you, and then you're on your own. You're given nothing. So this idea that migrants are taking, or that asylum seekers are taking money from others, it's simply not true. And then I think Sara even said this, then they're prevented from working for a long period of time, sometimes 6 months. So they can't work, they have no money, and they have no way to get around because of US policy. And then good-hearted people just step in the gap and fix the problem. And that just seems like, There's so many little solutions that could solve some big problems here. Maybe we can't get unity on the biggest questions of how many people can come in under what conditions, which we should solve. Because right now, I think we let like 680,000 people receive a citizenship work visa process here, 600,000 a year. In my view, so, it should be 3 million, not 600,000, but
yeah. I think you're right, and I want to tell a quick story really quickly. So, when I did my very first detained case, so some people when they come into the United States, they get put directly into immigration detention. Some people are given what's called alternatives to detention, so they have maybe check-ins, they might have an ankle monitor. You might have heard about those things. The detention though is really what gets me the most, because a lot of the people that are in immigration detention are there not because they violated any actual criminal law. And in states where people are detained, like Wisconsin, in state and county jails, you are housing people with people who are either convicted criminals who have actually done something wrong, with people who are absolutely innocent, having done nothing wrong except flee from some bad situation. So some of you may know Dodge County houses immigration detainees. Illinois passed a law a couple of years ago that prohibit those contracts, but many states still have them. And so many folks who are in the Chicago detained immigration court are actually held in Juneau, Wisconsin. And those people do not have easy access to counsel. There is no immigration legal services organization in Juneau, Wisconsin. They're covered by attorneys from Chicago. And for those people who are in Brown County, Juneau is about like an hour and a half to 2 hours away from Brown County. And again, like 2 hours from Chicago. It's not close. And this is on purpose. They put people places where there are not attorneys. They put people places where there are no resources, and that's on purpose. So I had the case that I did was for a young woman who actually was in Woodstock, Illinois, which is like an exurb of Chicago. It's probably a good hour and 15 minutes drive if there's no traffic from Chicago Detained Immigration Court. She came here by herself. She was 19, escaping gang violence. She had been raped in her own country and came during the summer. So she had a tiny backpack with nothing and no money. I represented her in court. And when she was released, she was released with nothing. She was released in the middle of the winter with summer clothes. The only coat she had was this big orange jail coat that they were kind enough to give her when she left. No phone, no way of getting in touch with anything. The only family she had was in Georgia, and she had ended up in Chicago. How are you supposed to, when you're 19 and you don't speak English, How are you supposed to safely get somewhere? How about if you don't have identification and you can't fly? How are you supposed to get to family somewhere so far away from where you happen to be detained and arrested? There's no rhyme or reason where people get sent. It just happens to be where there are empty jail seats, empty jail beds. What about that is humane? What about that is the right thing to be doing? Be putting somebody that's that vulnerable. So we went to Target and I bought her a bunch of stuff. I bought her a phone. I said, I'm not putting you anywhere unless I know that you can reach me if you need something. And that's, like I said, the cruelty is the point, and that can't be what an immigration system is built on. It just can't be.
When you guys tell these stories and you think about the cruelty and you think about the many Band-Aid patches, the many volunteers, the many asylum attorneys, people like both of you trying to help, systemically, the problem continues, and it continues on a massive scale. We're not the only ones trying to think about this. Earlier in the same series, we talked about some of the international mechanisms. And I'm going to drop a link into the chat right now to the UN Compact on Safe, Orderly, and Regular Migration, which comes from about 6 years ago, but it was an international document. Some of our friends with Jesuit Refugee Services helped design this. And even that phrase, the safe, orderly, and regular migration, feels like such a fantasy when we think about these realities on the ground. But it does it does describe general principles for what countries might do, and in this non-binding agreement say they will do. But when you think about overall policy, regardless of political party, knowing that this is going to be a major subject in upcoming debates, in the upcoming campaign, what are some of the things that we should listen for, look for, work for in terms of policy on immigration and the southern border in particular?
I'm going to guess that Doug has a whole list of talking points, because I'm sure this is a question he gets asked a lot. So I don't know, Doug, do you want to go first? And then, because I have a lot of ideas.
Sure. I'd be glad to, because I can't wait to hear your ideas. I think I put it in the chat or in the Q&A, a link to Veronica Escobar, Congresswoman Veronica Escobar from El Paso area. She is one of the leading advocates on what Congress needs to do. So if you're somebody who thinks that you like, somebody who cares about the policy side, there are policy solutions on what we should do. Look, this is... The problem is sophisticated and complex, but the answers are available to us. So there are answers. If you care, I put a link in there. You can look up also Veronica Escobar and look on her website, and she has all this. She's putting bills before Congress all the time, and they're being shut down either by Senate or by the House. So there are answers if you like that kind of thing. So if you want long-term outcomes, it's going to be policy, because policy's created the problem. But for a lot of people, they're like, I kind of want to do something right now. Like, what could I actually do? So there are people who's these organizations on both sides of the border that are working. There's refugee camps that are and asylum protection camps on the Mexico side of the border where people are living. And you can be in touch with those folks. Our website, votecommongood.com, has access to that. And there's also groups like you saw with Tiffany Burrows and others on the U.S. side that are doing this work. One of the things that you have to have as an asylum seeker in the United States is you need to say that you have people in the United States who will care for you when you come. You have to have a name and an address as a part of your application. A lot of these folks don't have it. So what can happen to some folks is that they're told by others of people who will serve in that role. Then they get in the United States, and this is how a 16-year-old kid ends up working in a Tyson chicken plant in Arkansas. So it's not always safe for people even to get in the country. So if you're someone who said, I'm willing to give my name to an asylum seeker or a family, so when they come, they could come to where I live in Wisconsin, and we would help them. We would take them up, form your own circle of support. They actually need someone to do that, and then to help them process through the system. So if you want to be someone who, I promise you, there's a lot of people.
Yeah, welcome core.
Yeah, there's a lot of people in asylum camps that have my name and phone number and address. And
what Sara just referenced, Welcome Corps, is part of an official, I spoke of privatization before, but it's
100% pushing off the
an offloading to institutions, to self-made groups or self-organized groups, to colleges sometimes who are attempting to help in this way.
Yeah. And so what I understand, like we're part of a circle that did this with some Afghan refugees. My wife and I are part of that. We're now dear friends with the family that came in the country. And what that is, were people that were already in the United States and then in a place where they were waiting for a group or organization to help settle them.
Yeah, that's okay, a little bit different. Yeah. So this is a little bit different. So Welcome Corps is saying, I will sponsor you people who are outside of the country to come in. It's a little bit of a different setup. So on an asylum application, there's no legal requirement that you put somebody's name down that's like in the United States. That's part of the interview when they do the border screening to see if you have any ties to the United States. Yep. So it's not a legal requirement. I just want to just be really—
Thank you.
Like, I have to be the lawyer, right? I have to be like the stickler about what's the legal requirement versus what's not. And so when you have folks coming in, they get a screening. And part of that is a credible fear interview. And that's what you were talking about, where they talk to an asylum officer, which is actually another problem, is that right now, all of the asylum officers that are supposed to be hearing cases in cities that have asylum offices, that's separate from immigration court. So there's two parallel tracks for claiming asylum. One is affirmative, and that's with an asylum office, and one is defensive, and that's an immigration court. So an asylum officer is detailed from the cities. So for example, the Chicago Asylum Office, all of their asylum officers are hearing credible fear interviews at the border because they're changing what a credible fear interview is. Before, a credible fear interview was just done by not a full asylum officer. And so these folks are being taken because there's not enough resources. And this goes to the actual question of what do I think could be better? Those people can't hear asylum cases for people who are affirmatively applying for asylum because they're being pulled to the border. So you have these massive backlogs. You have people who are waiting 6 years for an interview, and then another 6 years for a decision. But in the asylum offices, what happened a couple of years ago is that they changed the order of the people that they were going to be interviewing. First, they said whoever applies first gets decided first. Then they had to switch it to say, well, we have this huge backlog. We're going to put those people on the backlog because nobody's case is actually getting decided. We'll say whoever comes in now will go out first. So last in, first out, to try to get the backlog, which is a horrible idea. And then you had the Afghan evacuation crisis. Yep. And instead of coming up with an actual way for those people to all get green cards, they got shoehorned into the asylum process, which was already backed up. So now nobody's case is being heard except for Afghans who have expedited processing. So now you have another backlog on half of the other backlog. And that's in addition to the 3.6 million people who are waiting for a hearing in front of a judge, right? So this system is so broken. It totally does not work at all. And so what does it need? It needs more resources. It needs streamlined laws. So for example, when the Afghan folks came, and this is something that I will never truly understand, on both sides of the aisle, everybody's like, yeah, these people definitely should be here, but we can't pass a law to just give them green cards. We're going to make them be re-traumatized, tell their whole story again, and then make them wait, and then charge them right now almost $1,500 to get a green card. Most Afghans that are not special immigrant visa holders have to wait at least 8 months and technically a year of physical presence, then pay almost $1,500 to get a green card. Right. And that's because we messed up your country. Yeah. Right. And so if that's not enough to animate you to understand that this could have been a very simple congressional fix. You pass one Afghan Adjustment Act, which is and an Adjustment Act is not without historical precedent. You pass that, you set up a new system. Everybody gets green cards. You don't ruin a system you already had and then charge people a bunch of extra money just because you're a jerk.
And to compound that, border wall costs, according to the federal government, $20 million a mile. They wanted to build 738 miles for $15 $1,000 for a wall to keep people? And how much are they going to put into asylum officers?
Yeah, none of it. And see, this is the problem. USCIS, which is the entity that administers the affirmative asylum cases, right? The Executive Office of Immigration Review administers the courts, but the ones that are just in affirmative posture, USCIS doesn't get any federal funding. It is entirely self-supported by its own fees. Why is that the case? Right? And USCIS just hiked their fees in April of this year to make things much more expensive. And I think that's part of the problem. USCIS should not be supported on its own fees.
No.
I think that Congress should have separate appropriations. I think we need comprehensive immigration reform. And there have been some good bills that have come through, right? Not everything's perfect, right? But just like the tax code, you could not set out to write a more complicated immigration code if you started from scratch and you said, I'm here to like make it as complicated as possible. You could not make it more complicated than it already is. And we're dealing with an immigration code from the 80s, right? In its substance, right? Obviously there have been different laws that have been passed that have changed it, but the foundational code existed at a time when global migration was not like it is today, where we weren't facing climate change issues. We're not dealing with a bunch of political strife. I mean, it's a very different era now than when the last comprehensive immigration reform was passed. If nothing else, we need to modernize it and have it make sense. USCIS has made, has made efforts to try to make things simpler, but all of them are technology solutions, many of which are not helpful to people who don't speak English, and many of which are still quite glitchy and still require you have access to the internet or a smartphone. And so those things aren't helping a big part of the population that needs the help.
And we're up against it time-wise now. So I think we're gonna move to wrap up. It feels like we could describe the problem.
I can talk about this for forever.
You know, indefinitely. One that we haven't spoken to is the rhetorical problem, where politicians, especially Republicans, often speak of the crisis at the border as an invasion. And the word makes it sound like the U.S. is under threat from a foreign adversary and inclines toward a military solution. I can imagine how that kind of language would affect the people that you're working with, would affect attitudes toward the people you're working with. And it seems that we need not only new policies, but we need a new way to speak about what's happening on the southern border, what's happening with these individual families, these faces that you know. So I would just invite you in closing, each of you, to say just any final words, but what you think we can do or need to do, not just in terms of policy, but in terms of our individual attitudes toward this complex problem.
Sarah, Doug, do you want to go first? Me to go first? Okay. Sure. I think, you know, as we think about what we can do, what individual people can do. I often talk to a lot of lawyers. That's the community that I'm usually talking to, trying to get people to take these cases. But I think when we talk about what every individual person can do, everybody has skills. Everybody has something. Even if that's just a warm drink for somebody, even if that's just holding somebody's hand, even if that's just being there, right, and supporting other people's advocacy. You don't have to go and ride your bike if you don't want to. I think it's awesome, Doug, that you did that. It's fantastic. But if you don't want to do that, you don't have to. There is a way for every single person here to be engaged and to be following what's going on. And so what I invite you to do, and this is a skill that everybody has, is to challenge, right? If somebody says something, don't just let it happen. Say, where are you getting that information? Let me tell you a story about somebody that I know, right? And if you don't have a story about somebody you know, go make one. That's the best thing that you can do, because being a citizen in the United States is a privilege. There is a real long list of people who wish that they could be sitting in your shoes if you're a citizen of the United States. So use your power to help other people. And it doesn't matter, like I said, what it is, but everybody here has some kind of power that you can marshal for good. And I encourage you to think about ways that you can do that in your own life.
Wow, so good. So good. Sorry, we had a little power outage in my house. So I jumped on my phone here. Sorry to miss out on any of that. So good, Sara. I completely echo that. And look, use your creativity. I know sometimes all this pain and all this trauma can cause all of us to just sort of freeze and not know what to do. These kind of intractable moments require us to be more creative. We just have to find better ways to work around all of this madness. We have struggled in this country from our founding to know who's included in the we of we the people. There's nothing more American than not including everyone in the we. So we're going to keep working on it. And we join with the long history of others in the, you know, 2.5 hundred years of this country to try to figure out how do we make this a place where the we makes more sense for all of us. So I would encourage you into creativity. And as Sara said, figure out yourself. If you're a policy person, get into it. And if all this seems so bedazzlingly complicated, well, welcome. We all feel that way. I've lived my whole life with eczema. So I don't know if anybody else has eczema. I used to have it as a kid on my feet. Now I have it on my hands. After all this time, I really don't know what eczema, I don't know where it comes from. I don't know why I have it. I'm not sure really what it is. I know it's symptoms. I know it's pain. And I know if I put certain things on it or stay away from certain foods, it gets better. I don't have to know everything about it to know what to do. So you can find a way to do something. Please don't let the bedazzlingly complicated and broad-based complexities freeze you up for too long. Figure out some kind of a response and solution. And when you're in a conversation with someone and they say something and you don't really understand and you don't know and you misspeak a refugee from an asylum seeker, from a migrant, from somebody under temporary protective status, from a dreamer, it's okay. You don't have to know all of that stuff. You can respond in some ways. That sort of makes sense for you. And if you're paying any attention to this, you are so much further down the road than everybody else. You're probably the person who knows more about immigration, asylum seekers, refugees than anyone else you know. So consider yourself an expert who's also a beginner at the same time. And that's where we all find ourselves in this work.
John Paul Lederach, in his work on peace building, says that complexity is our friend. It's our friend because we can start anywhere. You know, when you look at a problem that looks like a 40-foot tall piece of, wow, or of tangled string, it doesn't really matter where you start untangling. Just start somewhere. And you don't have to find the perfect policy, the perfect beginning, or wait for the perfect hero to show up. You can start somewhere. So I want to thank you both. This is the last in our series of four webinars on refugee resettlement in America. If you missed any of the others, you can see recordings on the Mothi Center Facebook page or on my really modest YouTube channel, which is just at Robert A. Pine, YouTube at Robert A. Pine. I'll drop the link in here to the chat. Also, I'd like to thank Echelon Meyer, who's been working in the background today. Also, thanks to Jill Olson, who helped set up this series of webinars. And thanks especially to today's guests, Doug Pagitt and Sara Ghadiri. Thanks so much for joining us. Really appreciate you all. And thanks to everybody who sat and listened. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. And thanks, Doug.
Hey, thank you. It's really great.
Take care.